Welcome everyone to Technocamps, International Women's Day Celebration 2021, where we'll be celebrating gender equality in STEM. For those who don't know very much about us, I thought I'd just give you a little intro, a little bit of a heads up on who we are. Technocamps is a digital upskilling program. We're more than one project. We're a program. We reach into schools, communities, and try to support the pipeline of talent Wales needs and will need for a prosperous future, including fully funded degree apprenticeships. It started a long time before I came, though. It started way back in 2003 with Betty Williams and Professor Farah Moller. And this is actually our 21st such celebration, under the banner of ITWales, celebrating women in IT, recognising that technology is here and is advancing to help us and support us in work, in education, and in our leisure time. Now, you may have some early birds amongst us who got something in the post. I did. We had the opportunity to cut my speech short, which is great. For you, it makes the evening shorter and more enjoyable. We sent the annual report. It had all the details about what we've been doing over the past year, and even in a pandemic we managed to fill quite a few pages of an A4 document. So that's great news. The programme for tonight was there too, and also some seeds to plant, and hopefully you'll get a wonderful flower that's a reminder of International Women's Day. And I have to do this, which is choosing to challenge for tonight. You may have also had a camera shield to keep those unwelcome visitors from your living room. And I love mine, it's great. It's a really good addition. Our goal for you tonight then, what is it? Is to have fun celebrating IWD. It's also to learn something new. And it's also to be inspired to do something new. We'll have a section where we've got questions and answers, and we'll have, there's also the chat function. So you see the Q&A at the bottom, you can also see the chat function. If you've got any questions, any burning questions, any really hard questions for Kirsty, for Gwen, or for Nia, not for me, then please put them in the Q&A and we'll answer those at the end of the session. And chat and introduce yourselves in the chat function. So we really want you to enjoy this evening, have a really good time, but what a different year it has been, and it really has been a different year. Normally at this time of the evening I'd be putting on my glad rags and I'd be dressing up ready to go to a gala evening celebrating a lovely three-course meal amongst friends and amongst those people and supporters and all the team from the universities over a lovely dinner, chance to celebrate and a chance to chat together whilst having a lovely meal. Today's not so different though, because we are surrounded by our supporters. Thank you so many of you for joining us. May not have the lovely meal, but we can make the most of the support online and the fantastic speakers. We've still got fantastic speakers. We may be surrounded by a few extra people, maybe a little dog or a cat or a young child as well. I did make a little bit of an effort and put my glad rags on for you. I did put a little bit of sparkle on. So I have got joggers and slippers as well though. So we've got a great lineup for you tonight. Some formal speeches and recordings, some more informal, and I will introduce them as we go through the night. But the first thing up tonight is going to be our lovely ladies from Technocamps, the ladies who keep it all going, our delivery officers, inspiring in the schools and in the community, providing inspiring workshops and resources to develop the next generation. The talk that we're going to see is part of a much longer talk, and it'll be on YouTube later so everyone can see it. And the recording from this will be too. So you might not hear everybody talking on this clip because it is just a snapshot, and you'll feel as if, and I did feel as if I was sneaking in on their conversation, listening to what they have to say. So I'm gonna ask without any further ado, if we could roll the VT.
Okay, so as women, we are all women, hopefully. What Have you found you've sort of come up against any barriers or any issues of being like a woman in the science industry or the science workplace or the computing workplace? Has anyone come across anything?
I think sometimes you can be pigeonholed. Mm-hmm. So they'll put you in a box. That's the one thing I will say, is that there's a huge assumption sometimes that, and especially when you, so my role within Cardiff University is a little bit different. So of course I work with Technocamps and there's a lot of outreach, and it's not unusual that we do have quite a lot of women on our outreach team. And we have a lot of women in Technocamps who go out and deliver. So I don't think that's necessarily unusual, but it's kind of the box that you get put in. And the other things I do are around employability and placement. And there's an assumption that because I tend to do the non-technical subjects and I tend to cover them, that somehow I'm not technical. Mm-hmm. And I have to remind people constantly, I can code, I do code.
Yeah.
You know, and that sometimes is, I think, the issue, is that they will put you in a box. And surprisingly, you do hear comments like, oh, we need more of the softer subjects. I hate that phrase. And they usually mean anything that's related to businesses, modelling, that kind of thing, because that would appeal to girls. And the idea that if I put something business related into something tech, it will automatically appeal to girls and women is unbelievably offensive.
What experience have you had in industry directly as a woman, do you think?
First of all, they kind of, I mean, like, especially the number of women to men ratio is very less in the industry, even now. Mm-hmm. I mean, I joined industry in 1999 and I've been there until like a few years ago. So it's like been 18, 19 years. In all my time, there hasn't been any single company or project, even though I've worked with big companies. The projects usually have either one or two women, where you have at least six or seven men in there. And because of that, what happens is, first of all, the competition is way too high. Smaller projects, what happens, men tend to actually dominate. Even though you do more work, they kind of give you more work and get away with not doing it because you can't talk back, because they are the, people who are dominating at the moment.
Has anyone else, I mean, I know I wasn't going to talk much, but I know that when I did physics, because my degree is physics, so I did physics, there were three girls in my physics class at A level, and then it was sort of 20-80 split, girls, boys, in the lectures at Cardiff University, where Catherine was as well. So it was, yeah, it was quite daunting. And I generally didn't have much confidence in myself doing that course. So what advice would you give to girls who want to go into STEM subjects or want to go into computing now?
You know, you do sometimes get pigeonholed, and I'm not entirely sure that's a women's issue. I think that sometimes is an issue anyway in the workplace. If you show you're good at something, there is that assumption that you're only good at that. And it's understanding that there's a range of talents that you can have. But there's something kind of quite empowering about being a pioneer almost. And that's the one. And it's rare that you get that opportunity to be a pioneer in a field. But I think when you're a woman in computer science, you do get that opportunity to be a pioneer. So even now, I mean, 20 years, well, 20 years, more than 20 years ago, in 88, I did my BTEC in computing, and there were two girls on the course. And then my daughter did her BTEC 20 years later, and there were two girls on the course. And I thought, I can't believe that so little had changed in 20 years. But at the same time, there's that opportunity. So that's that. Don't be afraid to be that pioneer. Don't be afraid to be that person who does stand out, because you don't get many opportunities to do that. But in computer science, you still can. So it's almost like using that that poor gender diversity in a field to your advantage.
Your advantage. Yeah, definitely.
So rather than being put off by the fact that there's not many girls in computer science, go for it. You know, think, I'm going to be one of those pioneering women in a field. So that's my advice, is don't, you know, go out there and take that as an opportunity, use it as an opportunity rather than a disadvantage.
Yeah, I like that. Is there enough being done in computer science, do you think, specifically to get more women involved and more girls involved?
It's the people who are around women who needs more awareness about how to encourage them and not just focusing on the women, because you can tell them, because like in India, the number of girls who actually pass with high marks on STEM subjects is always, always higher than men. But when it translates that into work, it is just the opposite. So what happens there is that the parents are happy to not encourage the girls to go into BSc physics or chemistry or computer science, because then they don't become marriage material anymore. So they have to give a higher dowry for those things. It still exists, to be honest. So those things actually stop them from promoting their kids to just do what they want to do. It's less so now, but again, and the mentality of men also is changing, but is there enough being done to actually, you know, ensure that the equality in their minds is something which is like a norm and not, you know, yeah. thing that we have to promote.
So Nia, I know you worked in science outreach and things like that. So what's your opinion on that?
Rama's really hit the nail on the head talking about the influence of parents, because I think a lot of parents, they don't know what computer science is. They don't know what sort of jobs are available. I think I certainly, like, even my parents, they don't understand like the way that the world works now. They don't understand how like the modern job market works. And they've got a very different idea of what a job should be to what, you know, to what me and my brother sort of think. I also think a big problem with girls in particular is if you go to a primary school, and you ask kids questions or say, do you have any questions? Like, boys and girls put their hands up. And once you get to secondary school, there comes a point where actually the girls aren't going to say anything. And like, you'll go and talk to them later, you know, where it's just like you one-on-one, and they'll have the best questions and they will clearly have been listening and they'll will be interested in it, but they're not confident enough for whatever reason to talk in front of the classroom. And yeah, I think that's a really, it's a really difficult problem to solve from my own personal experience. When I was trying to decide which A-levels to do, I didn't know whether to go down the arts or the sciences route. And my maths teacher, who I was terrified of, came up to me and said, you are going to do A-level maths and you are going to do AS further maths. And I was so scared that I said yes. And it's the best bit of advice that I've ever had.
That's good.
Yeah, I've never regretted it.
The role model thing is a real, really important thing.
I think it is a really important thing. But I think the other issue we've got is the people who are trying to solve this. It is a problem. And then you've got people who are trying to solve the problem, but the people who are trying to solve the problem are men who think they know what women want. And that is a massive issue for me. It's a massive issue when you've got the people who are designing qualifications for computer science, for the science subjects, are men, but they're trying to put things into those qualifications that they think will appeal to girls rather than actually getting girls involved. And it's one of those things, like when you get to university level, for example, and you're looking at individual modules and subjects, you can involve the students more in module redesign. And I think we don't involve kids enough in qualification redesign. So if we're going back and we're designing qualifications and we're designing them with the idea of appealing to a subset of the, you know, of the school, then we need to get those involved. You know, we shouldn't be designing qualifications for girls without asking girls what it is that appeals to them about computer science, or what is why do you not like it? And one of the common reasons you get when you ask why don't you like it is this massive assumption that to be good at computer science, you need to be good at maths. Now, what we've found is that because we don't ask for maths A level, what we found is that people who come with A levels in the arts or psychology, sociology, they tend to do much better because they're bringing this whole subset of skills.
Their understanding of people as much, because of the user experience and that sort of thing when you're designing things for people.
And that is kind of really, they do really well at computer science.
There's this weird idea that it's like that problem solving and thinking creatively are two different things. Clearly the same issue. It's
yeah, just, definitely.
You've rebranded one for boys and branded one for girls. Yeah. That's all it is.
Yeah, well said, yeah.
You know, and like if you look at the history of computer science, like the first people who did programming were women because it was considered women's work. Mm-hmm. And the way that you wrote about it and took, like it was, I read something that referred to it as like secretarial. You know, that's what programming is.
The admin,
You
know, and yeah, you know, it's just as time has gone on and programming, you know, there's all these opportunities. It's been rebranded as something that's, you know, super, super logical. And, you know, female patience has been, you know, changed to be like, oh, actually you need like this weird, like very male idea of like sticking to a problem and solving it, you know, and it's all, yeah, it's all the same thing. We've just changed the word. I do think even small changes like that in the way we talk about computer science will have a big influence.
So what advice do you think we could each give to a group of girls or an individual who comes up to and say, no, how can I get into STEM? How can I get into computing?
It's a hard one because I think sort of if it's someone that's already maybe interested in it, that sort of side of advice is almost you kind of just need to tell them just to go for it, I think, more than anything. But I think the other side of it is then the people that maybe aren't so interested. One thing I really found was when I was coming to the end of my degree and I was starting to look for jobs, the amount of jobs that I was looking for that weren't typical, you know, just like a graduate software engineering job or a graduate computer science that was predominantly sort of coding. There were so many different jobs that I was looking at, and there were, you know, in medical, and then looking in even in law and things like that. And it said you need some form of programming experience. So you needed a degree and it didn't specify what degree, and you needed programming experience. And all my friends that had done either medical degrees or law degrees or, you know, any other STEM degree couldn't apply for it because they didn't have the coding experience. But I did. So it meant that I was qualified to do so many different things that maybe they weren't. So that's sort of my more advice is that it's, yeah, looking at the sort of the bigger picture of it, and actually in so many different industries, you need to have some form of programming experience. You need to have that way of thinking of, you know, the problem solving and the creativity that we've spoken about. And that, yeah, definitely considering computer science and more.
But don't be shuttered off to other things. Yeah. So it's not just computer science. It opens up the world of other things. Yeah.
That idea of changing the world, and I think if you want to change the world today, you do it through technology.
Mm-hmm.
We only have to look at how much we've grown in the last 20, 30 years. It's one of those, my nan, she was 94 when she passed away. And I remember having a conversation with her about the advantages to having such a long life. She loved the fact that she was in her 90s and that she, you know, she was enjoying this really long life. And she said to me, the best advantage is technology.
And watching, how it's improved.
And watching. My nan was always one of these women that it didn't matter what came out, as soon as something came out, she had to have it. So she was the first person in her street to have a microwave.
Oh, brilliant.
You know, and the entire street turned up at her kitchen to watch it, some beans in the microwave. I mean, this is the type of woman she was. And then when the iPads come out, she had to have an iPad so she could do online shopping. You know, this is who she was. She had a
embracing
mobile phone.
And
that's what she said. And I think that's kind of makes me feel actually, yeah, that's right. When you're changing the world, and you are changing the world, technology allows you to do that. I mean, my nan having an iPad in her 90s enabled her to do internet shopping when she couldn't go out and do shopping by herself anymore, but she had complete independence still. So, and I think if you want to change the world, get into tech.
Brilliant. I think that's a brilliant note to end on.
I have to agree, what a brilliant note to end on. Aren't they just amazing? Yeah, that's diolch Swyddogion dysgu, definitely. Thank you, delivery officers, you're amazing. They are a real true inspiration. Our next inspiration, though, after that discussion, is Kirsty Williams. She doesn't really need much introduction from me, I don't think at all. I think everybody's seen quite a lot of you on the television recently. Minister for Education in Welsh Government since 2016. One of the most challenging roles of the past year, for sure. We welcome you this evening. We thank you so much for coming and joining us at Technocamps and taking the time out this evening. Over to you to share with us and inspire us further.
Well, nice of our power, Bonadigion and Bonadigasai. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm delighted to be here to celebrate International Women's Day with you. And a massive thank you to Julie and the Technocamps team for organising the event. And oh my goodness me, absolutely. Those wonderful delivery officers. I couldn't agree more with the sentiments that they've expressed prior to this introduction of my comments this evening. I'm overwhelmed that so many people have taken the chance to join us this evening. A special shout out to my cabinet colleague, Julie James, the Minister for Local Government, but obviously the member of the Senate for Swansea West, who I know is in the audience and has been a true example of the sisterhood in the support that she has given me over what has been the most challenging year of my entire working life. But to the matters in hand, I think we could all agree that we've made great strides to address gender equality in STEM. But as we've just heard from the delivery officers, and when the Economic Forum tells us that gender parity is some 200 years away, well, my goodness me, we've still got an awful long way to go and a lot of work to do. So collectively, we need to keep challenging those stereotypes to ensure that Wales has a STEM education system that works for all young people of all backgrounds, because never before has science and technology been so important in meeting global challenges, not least the COVID-19 pandemic and, of course, our climate crisis. Well, I know that today there will be, and if you've looked on Twitter, some may question the need for International Women's Day. After all, they're quick to point out that, my goodness, they let us vote these days. We have the Equal Pay Act, the Equality Act, and the Human Rights Act. And we have many international conventions and treaties enshrining equality and protection for women and girls. But my goodness me, the reality behind those initiatives, hard fought and hard won, progress. Globally, girls are still less likely to be educated. Fewer women work in technology and in government. And so for me, empowering girls and young women has never been more important in these areas. And the UK's STEM skill shortage is a well-documented phenomenon. It's projected, as you will know, but that by 2024, there will be a significant growth in the proportion of professional STEM jobs here in the United Kingdom. Yet, despite increasing numbers of women going to university, and filling highly skilled jobs, there has not been a similar increase in the number of women employed in traditionally male-dominated scientific or professional fields. So we need to tap into that talent of those traditionally underrepresented groups who can become the scientists, the engineers, the technicians, and computer science experts of the future. And addressing these shortfalls is critical to our nation's future, if we want to develop an innovative economy with a strong technology base. Of course, crucial to all of this, and my interest is in the issue of education. And my mission for education during my time as the minister has always been to raise standards, reduce the attainment gap, and deliver an education system that is a source of national pride and enjoys public confidence. And we need to do more to ensure that our young people don't miss out on the life skills learned through a high quality STEM education, such as the innovation and the critical thinking, planning and personal effectiveness that we've just heard about. These are skills which can lead to exciting and well-paid STEM careers. Now, I want all of our learners to become ethical, informed citizens of Wales and the world, healthy, confident individuals ready to lead fulfilling lives as valued members of our society. And it's essential that our education system raises aspiration and challenges stereotypes in order to address underrepresentation in different careers. And of course, that goes both ways. our Technocamp delivery partners just talked about stereotyping girls into particular roles. We know in our schools that often our young men, our boys also feel stereotyped into taking certain subjects. And there's almost a direct opposite in the number of males taking computer science as opposed to girls taking literature and vice versa. And as we've just heard, there is a cross-fertilisation of the skill sets that having a broad, balanced curriculum can truly deliver. So we are transforming the curriculum to help us fulfil that mission. And that curriculum will be crucial in preparing our young people to lead fulfilling personal and professional lives. Now, the Welsh Government is now giving priority to supporting the teaching and learning of STEM subjects, because we know that that will make a difference to individuals' futures and the future of our nation. But despite the high priority placed on those subjects, we know that relatively small numbers of girls and women are likely to pursue them. And by the time they get into college, for example, 58% of female students believe that jobs that require programming or coding are not jobs for them. And as long as half the population is less than fully represented in STEM, we will miss out on those diverse perspectives needed to drive innovation and solve today's toughest problems. And of course, diversity isn't about altruism. Organisational cultures that exclude or lack diversity, well, they constrain opportunities and the chance of progression, and have also been shown to limit their own performance as organisations. So greater diversity in the workforce brings a host of additional benefits to business. The good news is there are steps that we can all take to close the gender gap in STEM. And one of our key priorities is to ensure that children and young people have equal opportunity to obtain the digital skills required to gain sustainable employment, which is, again, an absolute crucial building stone for an economic prosperous Wales. The four purposes of our new curriculum are that shared vision and aspiration for every child and young person. And in fulfilling these, we've set high expectations for all to promote individual and national well-being, to tackle ignorance and misinformation, and to encourage critical and civic engagement. And we've strengthened our commitment towards activities that break down the barriers to studying STEM for children, actively encouraging girls to continue to study those subjects where they are currently underrepresented, and to demonstrate to girls the interesting and well-rewarded careers and the chance to be the pioneers that we've just heard about in STEM industries. Gender equity is now featuring in all of the Welsh Government's related funding programmes, including Technocamps, TechniQuest, Explore, our support for programmes designed by the Institute of Physics, the Engineering Education Scheme Wales, and the Further Math Support Programme. And in a recent review of STEM enrichment activities, it was found that there is loads and loads of impactful work being delivered right the way across Wales. So this is my chance to give a massive thanks to the contribution that Technocamps is playing to that. Can I conclude by thanking you all for being here this evening, and the personal commitment that each and every one of you is bringing to tackle this agenda. It does not go unnoticed here in Welsh Government, and we are committed to continuing to work in partnership with you to deliver on the equality agenda that means so much to all of us and can lead to a brighter future for our nation. Diolch yn fawr.
Diolch yn fawr to you, Kirsty, too. Thanks so much. Thanks also for supporting us with our programme over the years, because it's a great partnership and we couldn't do it without you and without your support. So that's really, really good. And it's good to know that we're sitting in a good place in that priority. I know we're delivering well, and I know we're delivering something of value, and that's good too, you know. So thank you, and thanks for joining us this evening. I'm looking forward to the questions. Hope you've got those burning questions ready for Kirsty. Make them really hard. No, don't. No, you're joking. Make them fun, and make them and personal, and make them relevant. Okay, so now we're going to move on to another video clip. This is from Jacqueline DeRoches. Now, Jacqueline DeRoches is the co-chair of the Institute of Coding, and in Wales, we are in partnership with the Institute of Coding. And Jacqueline is also the chair of the board of digital leaders of UK Tech UK. So how is Jacqueline with us tonight? She's with us via video. She was supposed to be with us in person last year, and she'll mention that on the video. I came across her on a Sunday morning when two of the team texted me and said, "You must listen to this person, they're great." She was on Desert Island Discs. She was really passionate about her story, and it's just a great story. So I'm not going to say any more. I'm going to let her inspire you with the video. So I get to say it again. Roll the VT, please.
My name's Jacqueline DeRocas, and I am the president of Tech UK and the co-chair at the Institute of Coding. Happy International Women's Day 2021, and many thanks for inviting me to your wonderful festival and celebration of women. I was due to join last year, but as it turns out, I was likely one of the early victims of the pandemic and didn't make it to Swansea. I'm delighted to join you here today and want to thank the Sisterhood and our Manbassadors for lifting up women and for choosing to challenge in the International Women's Day theme 2021. As we start this year, sadly, in the shadow of COVID-19, Black Lives Matter, and the rise of incredibly disturbing geopolitics, we watch as the world demands a level playing field for all. But frankly, I believe there has never been a better time to be a woman, and specifically never been a better time to be a woman in science, technology, engineering, and maths. Not only because women are the change makers, the ones who are taking up their cause for themselves and future generations, but also because this is our opportunity to build a technology future that cuts through bias and builds a world that works for everyone. Talking about bias, witness the incident of a doctor who couldn't gain access to the locker room at the gym. Her swipe card wasn't working. And trying to identify the issue, the team responsible tried a number of different ways of solving the problem, including swapping out the swipe card, and finally, by studying the programming. And they realized that the job title doctor had been hard-coded as a male job title, and that's why this female doctor couldn't get access. Now, this is a really small example of bias, probably unconscious, but it goes to show that unless we have women and minority voices designing, building, and testing this technology, we will continue to perpetuate these biases, which, by the way, is so endemic, we've stopped seeing them. So a small example of unconscious bias, perhaps, but we're also living under rules and regulations increasingly made by algorithms that decide whether you get that job interview, that place at university, or that loan. So we had better make sure, again, that the teams that design them are diverse. Otherwise, we will create a digital world that inadvertently doesn't work for everyone. Perhaps most importantly, machines and software then learn from their environments. So the data that they learn from must not be biased. We must be working with clean data. It's so influential in society and in our lives, you know, with new innovations right from artificial intelligence to virtual reality. And our representation matters. Women hold up half the sky, let's face it. So when diverse voices are excluded from decisions that shape these views, we will be pushing divisiveness to the forefront of our society. Our lives are more dependent on technology than ever before, and tech adoption has gone through the roof. You are all experts in Zoom and Teams and BlueJeans and Google Hangout. So, you know, we know that we are all dependent on the technology future much more than ever and much faster than ever before. My aging parents are able to press one button on their tech silver tablet and they can video call me on a whim, which is both a blessing and a curse at times, but bless them, we are connected. And this explosion in tech dependency is precisely why there is unprecedented demand for more computer scientists, more data analysts, more programmers, more women and minority voices that need to be represented in tech. And I will reiterate again that if we are to thrive in a digital future, we must ensure that all of our voices are around the table when designing this tech. We can't afford to continue to perpetuate biases, especially ones that we don't see anymore. And if you want more examples of these kinds of biases, read a book called Invisible Women by Caroline Criado Perez. I'm sure you've either seen it or been given it for Christmas, but it has mind-blowing examples of how large the gap is for women versus men in so many ways. There's an example in there of, you know, there are still police stab vests that are not created for humans with breasts. And we know that there have been police women around for rather a long time. So how mad is that? Anyway, the experience of this pandemic has driven people towards STEM subjects. And it's for all to see that it's nothing short of unprecedented to go from discovering a virus amongst us just over 12 months ago to sequencing its genome, to understanding and building at least 8 effective vaccines. And the reason we could do this is not because we threw money at the problem in late 2019, 2020, although I'm sure that's helped accelerate the outcomes, but it's because we have had that capacity. We've had those series of experts, the research students, the postgrads, the postdocs, all the way to professors who've been funded for many, many years and who have the knowledge base. It may not be specific COVID-19 knowledge, but because there is a solid science base, we've been able to leverage that to our advantage. So education matters, research matters, and every day we have seen scientists become the face of government advice, bringing us that everyday guidance. And when you see these role models, you feel very keenly the opportunity they afford for you to follow in their footsteps. Thankfully, we have witnessed both men and women in this role, but we need more women, because the stats are still too low to be properly representative. Women account for less than a third of those employed in research and development across the world. And on the board of technology companies themselves, the representation of women is about 18%. So you see, if you're thinking that diversity doesn't matter, or it's not your problem to solve, choose a career in technology, in computer science, in digital, so that you can become part of the solution. Some people think that diversity is not their problem to solve, but consider this. I believe the greatest threat to diversity and inclusion is the belief that someone else will fix it. So every tiny shift you make in your own behavior to be more inclusive, more tolerant when faced with someone who works differently, eats differently, looks differently, comes from a different culture, all of your inclusive behavior exponentially improves better outcomes for an inclusive culture. Or even if you're in a meeting where it's clear that there are missing diverse voices, stick your hand up to challenge and ask, where are the others? As I said, I believe there's never been a better time to be a woman in science, technology, engineering and maths. First, because companies will be held to account if they have not embraced diversity. And second, because of the risk of perpetuating bias. Perhaps finally, though, because of something said by one of the world's finest role models, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who reminds us all that we need more women in positions of influence, because women belong in all the places where decisions are made. The theme for this year's International Women's Day is Choose to Challenge. And that gives us all an opportunity to renew our commitment to equal the playing field for all. Have a wonderful festival, and thank you for lifting up other women.
Thanks, Jacqueline, for that. It's tremendous, isn't it? I feel as if I should be doing this again to choose to challenge. gender equality again. So we should all stand and do this for a minute. But it was fabulous, and it was fabulous to hear from her and to listen to her inspiration for us. And the quality of that video was just amazing. Now, without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to Gwen Parry-Jones. Gwen, I met actually almost a year ago. It was STEM called Gogleth, which is another STEM project which deals with mentoring, was launching in North Wales last year, this time last year. I was privileged to go to the launch. I was privileged to listen to Gwen speak and met her for the first time. Gwen works in nuclear power. I know a little bit about nuclear power because I've watched the Chernobyl series, and that's all I know. But it is a little bit of something, and it's fantastic if you haven't seen it. 9.4 on the ratings, so definitely worth it. Gwen works for is the CEO of Magnox, and Magnox is a huge company. I looked it up, almost as half a billion a turnover and 2,000 employees. And it's huge. So I just want to get that scale across. I just think it's amazing what you're doing, Gwen. And she's going to tell us all about it. So I'm going to hand over to her to tell us her wonderful story.
Well, fabulous. And how do you follow Jacqueline? She was amazing. Well, firstly, thank you so much to the organisers, and particularly for the gifts, because I can tell you that the mouse mat matches my curtains too. And if I'd have been really clever, I'd have got the colour on my T-shirt as well. And also, I've planted my seed, so I'm really looking forward to figuring out what's going to come out of that. It would be lovely to meet in person as well, so hopefully in future years we can. But when I was looking through the material that you sent out in advance of the conference, I was really struck by the quality of the people involved. Betty Williams as the founder, Professor Farron Moller as the director, our lovely host today, Julie, but also the co-speakers. So sharing a stage, as I am doing with Kirsty, Jacqueline and Nia, is a great privilege. And I think the work you're doing, you know, 7,025 pupils engaged, 123 schools, 400 workshops, amazing work. So who am I? Well, I'm Gwen Parry-Jones, and as Julie kindly introduced me, I'm the CEO of Magnox. And I'm also the president of the Nuclear Institute for the next couple of years. And my claim to fame, which I'll come back to, is I am the only female station director, or have been, of a commercial nuclear reactor in the UK. Magnox today is 12 nuclear sites spread across the UK. And as Julie mentioned, I look after around about between 2,000-4,000 people, depending on the work we're doing. And we spend round about £500 million, so half a billion pounds a year. And today I just want to talk about three things, actually. I want to talk about the imperative of diversity and inclusion. I want to talk about science and why I believe science is fun. And I also want to just talk a little bit about the lessons that I have learned along the way. When I was looking at my notes for this next section, which is to talk about the imperative of diversity and inclusion, my little note says, a case of mistaken identity. So today I thought I might wear this T-shirt just to make sure that nobody was in any doubt of what it is I do or who I am, because actually you'd be surprised about the number of times that I have been a case of mistaken identity. I'll just tell you a little story. When I was a station director of a nuclear power station in the northwest of England, we had round about 2,000 people on site every day doing a huge amount of work. And we'd had a year without any accident or injury to an individual. So we thought we'd have a celebration. So who doesn't like coffee and cake, eh? So we decided to have a day of coffee and cake. And I spent the day in the canteen serving coffee and cake to all the employees and talking with people about their work. It was a great day. The next morning, as normal, I decided to go up to the reactor pile cap. So that's on top of the reactor, to have a look at the work that they were doing up there. And I could see a group of guys chatting away and sort of waving at me. So I thought, oh, I'll go over and say hello. So as I went across, one of them said, hello, love. I said, oh, hi there, how are you doing? What are you up to today? And he said, oh, you know what? It's really good that, you know. I said, you know, what do you mean? Thinking he meant how good it was that a leader like me came to have a look at, you know, my arrogance of looking at the work face. he said, it's brilliant you ladies from the canteen come up and have a look at this nuclear science. And I could see his friends behind him sort of making a stop, a comment. And he asked me my name and I said, oh, my name's Gwen. And he suddenly clocked that I was the station director. But, you know, you'd be surprised at the number of times that that has happened. You know, people who've emailed me, gentlemen, and they still do. People have asked me if I could possibly help them with some stationery or get me the yellow pages or something like that. And I have to say that I've always taken great, maybe it's revenge actually, but, you know, often I'll be then chairing a meeting where those people have asked me things like that. And it's a really good negotiating tactic to start off with somebody who's just asked you for the yellow pages. Actually, mistaken identity, or at least, you know, in terms of misrepresenting people, there's a lot within the public domain. And I'd urge you to have a look at a couple of films that I think are really important. One is called The Picture of Scientist, it's called, and it's by Wicked Delicate Films. Have a look at it. It's really interesting in terms of how we all picture scientists. But I hope you've also had a chance to watch the film Hidden Figures, because I think that that's a really good example of how women have been underrepresented in many fields. And that obviously is about the American space program. But moreover, you know, why is diversity so important? So here's a few stats for you. There's an urban myth, wasn't there, that there's more CEOs in the FTSE 100 called David than there are women. Well, I looked it up today, and apparently the number of female chief executives in the FTSE 100 is equal to the number of FTSE chief executives who are named Peter these days. You know, who can believe it? There's in terms of the FTSE 100, there's only 12.5% of those directors are women. And of the 350 top UK companies, only 14 are led by women. And 15% of those companies have no female directors at all. And this is against a backdrop where firms who've got at least a third women directors have profits which are 10 times more than firms who don't have a third female directors. You know, diversity is needed in our business. But, you know, it's not all bad news, because I think often about how the media represents women. And I know Nia is talking after me, and I'm sure she'll raise a number of these things. But, you know, if you look into how the media is portraying women these days, there's a number of really good developments, whether it's Doctor Who, you know, that's brilliant. But also, I'm no Disney aficionado, but my nieces will tell me that Frozen, Moana, Mulan are really very strong female characters now. How to Train Your Dragon, you know, Harry Potter, Star Wars, there's lots of them. Lisa Simpson of The Simpsons. But also, more seriously, newsreaders and panelists on some of the very serious political and scientific topics of the day. We are now seeing women represented, I think, more properly in those debates. So I think we've come an awful long way. But, you know, if you think about your own mental pictures, when you think of an IT leader, a coder, a surgeon, you know, an airline pilot, a scientist, what do you see? Do you see a man? Do you see a woman? Or doesn't it matter? Well, my proposition to you is it doesn't matter. But don't accept a mistaken identity. So moving on to my second topic for today, I'd also like to talk a little bit about science and why science is such a great topic to be in. So I'd just ask you a quick question. I'd like you all to picture what you think nuclear power is. I'd like you to close your eyes whilst you do this. And I can see you all, by the way, just in case you think I can't. No, I can't at all. So if you close your eyes, I bet you I can guess what your picture of nuclear power is, because it's either Homer Simpson or it's Chernobyl. And actually, I'd just like to offer you a different view of what nuclear power is. I actually saw in the news yesterday as well, there was a headline that says Meghan goes nuclear. So I thought, well, that's fantastic. Meghan and Harry are now going to be supporting nuclear power. But no, that wasn't the headline that followed after Meghan goes nuclear. So how about another mental image of nuclear power? Nuclear power provides 10% of the world's electricity. It's the second largest global source of low carbon power. There are 440 power reactors operating in the world. There are 220 research reactors, of which some are industrial and some are medical isotopes that they're producing. And between the nuclear industry, we now have 18,000 reactor years of experience in 31 countries safely generating clean power. And for those of you, I know there's many scientists on the call today, but for those of you who don't know what fission is, so nuclear fission is very simple, really. If this is a uranium atom, it's actually really heavy. And if you have a particle called a neutron and it hits it, the uranium atom gets so heavy it can't stay together, so it splits up. And when it splits up, it produces another neutron and some heat. And that other neutron then goes on, in some cases, to find another uranium atom and hits that, and hence you have a chain reaction. So all we're doing in nuclear power is producing heat from splitting of the atom through to producing steam, which then turns a turbine and then onwards into electricity generation. Simple, hey? But you know, nuclear, I think, has a role to play in net carbon zero. If you think about what will happen over the next generations, we are going to double our energy needs as we decarbonize transport and heating. And you know, I'm not telling you what to think. You will think what you think based on the facts, and that's great. But I actually think that we are going to be challenged to provide enough clean energy. And I would just propose to you that nuclear probably has a place in that. You know, where are we going to get the electricity from to charge our electric cars, heat our houses, whilst we protect our planet? So for me, nuclear power, coming back to the theme of today, you know, it's offered great challenges to me as an individual in terms of my career. I started off as a reactor physicist. I then became a reactor operator, but don't worry, I wasn't the Homer Simpson with the fuel element in my hoodie. I actually really enjoyed being a reactor operator. You know, when you lift the control rods on a nuclear power station, you're releasing as much energy as the launch power of the space shuttle. And I always found that a fascinating fact. And actually still, when I drive down the approach road to a nuclear power station, I get goosebumps. I get goosebumps at the ingenuity of making all of those components work together to safely produce electricity. I then went on to be a finance manager. I had some international work in Canada and the United States. I became a technical safety manager of a power station, a plant manager, and finally a station director, and then onwards to some other jobs after that as a board member. But you know, it's given me a great career path. And what I want to know is, where is the next female nuclear power station director? Are you in this room? Are you in this room with me? Because if you are, I'd really, really like to meet you. And it may be that that person is in your classroom too. And you know, one final comment about nuclear power, people often say, what about the waste? Well, for me, you know, I've come full circle from being involved in operating a nuclear power station right through to the work I do now, which is about remediating the waste. We know how to do it, we're getting on with the task, and it's a matter of, you know, getting those technical solutions. And we need the best people to keep doing that to make sure that we remediate our waste. The final area I just wanted to touch on was the lessons that I've learned during my career, my long career now, and it's amazing how quickly it goes, isn't it? The things I just offer to you, and a number of people have said this already, is you can be anything. How you think, how your parents think, how your teachers think, and what you see in terms of role models. Is there somebody who's like you in the roles that you want to do? I think those are the critical factors in giving people confidence to believe that they can be anything. And I'd urge us all to think about how we apply that to people around us. Do we give them the confidence that they can be anything? I also think, and it's been mentioned before at the beginning of this session today, but the importance of sponsors and mentors. And it isn't just mentors. You know, mentors, I think, can help you think through things and, you know, to test your ideas and to socialize things that you're working on. but the importance of sponsors has been particularly important in my career, where when that job comes up and they're considering who might be appropriate for it, somebody to say, well, what about that person over there? Why don't we give them a go? And I think, you know, nurturing a sponsor is a really important part of career development. And one thing that I guess came to me fairly late in my career is I always used to think about that success was about what you knew. And of course it is partly about what you know. But as I've got more senior and perhaps older, I've actually recognised that it's actually really about what you think. It's not just about what you know. And I think we have to start giving people confidence early in their lives to say what they think. You know, when I work with apprentices and graduates these days, they want to show me what they've learned and how much they know. But what I'm really interested in is what they think. So if we can nurture that earlier on in our careers, I think that will help us all. And finally, you know, in terms of the things I've learned, being yourself. Once you're able to be yourself, your authentic self, things become so much easier. You don't have to think, how will what I think be received by somebody else? Because actually, you know, what you think is really important, regardless of how somebody else might receive it. So I think being in an environment where you can be yourself is hugely important. And I think you have to use humour where it's appropriate to do so, to get through some of the hurly-burly, but also be able to draw the line and say that that's enough. And for the organisations that we're all in, to support people in drawing that line where needed. So for me, in terms of lessons I've learned, you know, I do choose to challenge. I choose to be the best version of myself, and I wish you to be the best versions of yourselves. And I would like you to choose to say what you think, because I think that will be how we all make progress. So in summary, for me, diversity and inclusion are not optional. There's many reasons to do it, and we're all here to support that. I think science is amazing, and I urge you to step into it if you haven't. And for me, it is about what you think, not just what you know. So thank you very much indeed. And next time you think about what a nuclear scientist looks like, it could be you. It could be somebody in your classroom. So thank you very much indeed. And I look forward to the questions.
Diolch yn fawr iawn. Fantastic, amazing. Thank you, Gwen, very much. Role models, I think you're certainly one of those for all of us. Whether we need to get some more, that's fine too, but you definitely hit that for me. Confidence, you have that in spades, but I think we all need to have that too. And I definitely was challenged on the thinking, being a thinker, which is really good too. So thank you very much. Thank you very much for that. Really, really good. I'm sure we'll all have taken something different from that this evening. And that's the whole point of this evening. It's very varied. We've got different types of speakers, some more formal, some, but the content, there's something in there for you to take away and think about in your journey and how you're challenging gender equality. Okay, now then, we're going to move on to Nia. Nia is the head of education for BBC Wales. Oh, what a year she's had. Certainly what a few months, change all the time. Schools open, schools shut, schools open, schools shut. And how can we support this? So Nia's had some issues with, unfortunately, with internet and with the power cut last night. So bless her, she's managed to provide a video for us. And we're going to play that now for you and have a listen to what she's got to say. But make sure now you've got your questions. I see a couple of questions coming into the Q&A. There's some good ones. Some are very directed. So think about those throughout Nia's tape. I'm going to run that video now.
Noswitha, everyone. Happy International Women's Day. My name's Nia and I work as the head of education at BBC Cymru Wales. And I'm responsible for leading our educational output for learners across Wales. Thanks so much to Technocamps for inviting me along tonight. I feel privileged to be talking alongside Kirsty, Jacqueline and Gwen, all three of them hugely inspiring women. I was asked to talk about my career path tonight. And in talking about that path, I hope that I'm able to shine a light on how technology, digital and the creative arts can offer endless opportunities for girls and women within the creative industries and to become senior leaders. I'll start with talking about how my interest in technology and digital was sparked. I was born in the late 70s. I played music on cassettes, something that many of you will be familiar with, others not, I'm sure. And we were recording TV shows on VHS tapes. The internet wasn't there for us. But there was a computer in our home. And for that, I was lucky. I loved playing with numbers. Both of my parents were mathematicians. And then at secondary school, algebra just seemed bonkers and amazing at the same time. It was code after all, and I really enjoyed art and words. Tim Berners-Lee invented the World Wide Web in 1989. Fast forward 8 years with a university degree in between, and I was desperate to work in the exciting world of the internet, combining computers, numbers, words, and art somehow. And then I started to teach myself code, not knowing which jobs would be available, but I just enjoyed it. I saw a web editor role advertised and tried for it. I built a fully working website for the interview, wrote all the copy, and it paid off. I got the job with a broadcaster, S4C. We were a small team of four, plus an IT department trying to help us realise our ambitions. I hadn't been through a formal computer science degree and there weren't any digital courses then, but I had the drive, determination, the creative ability and interest to learn code and make products. The IT staff working with us would later become software engineers, others UX designers and information architects, for example. I got to work with lots of animators, again combining tech with creativity. 5 years into producing projects, the head of that department decided to take a career break. I didn't even think about trying for the role. I was happy engineering products with my colleagues and applying my creative skills. Individuals in the IT department, those working around me and staff in the department started asking, why are you not applying for the role? I just wanted to make things. A senior person that had seen my work and how I was developing highlighted that I was already doing the role pretty much. I was leading in building products. I just didn't see it that way. So I did apply against a male colleague. And it wasn't a secret to anyone that one of the panelists on the interview really wanted the male colleague in the role. Females were rare in digital at the time, and a female colleague had a chat with me and urged me to go for it and not to lose confidence. I was given a really tough interview, but somehow managed to answer everything with detail. I got the job. I asked the female panelist if we both had the same questions, to which she replied, no. And this isn't something that you'll hear these days. But the reply I had was, I had to give you a tough interview to prove that you were exactly the right person for the job. I wanted to give you the opportunity to show what you could do. I also wanted you to realise how good you are in your job and the leadership qualities in you. It's obvious to me and others, but you can't see it. I want you to start seeing that. That was over 20 years ago, and I'll be forever grateful to that female for raising another woman. I enjoyed my job, but there was something missing. My university degree was based in education, and I wanted to do more than just entertain audiences. I wanted to make a difference to children's lives, to their education. And then a role came up with the education department, the BBC. I tried and I moved over to the BBC. It was a shock. landing in the BBC. All of the teams were separated. Engineers were in their own departments, editorial staff on their own, designers in another box. I really struggled to understand how anything could be done with everyone separated. I managed to persuade my boss at the time to allow me to set up a team pulling individuals with different skills together. I needed to make that work. Everyone that came on board loved the collaborative effort in building products. Editorial staff were learning about code, developers were learning about the challenges that copywriters had, and designers were teaching everyone about building accessible products. We were learning together, and staff were gaining more rounded skills. I loved making products that were leveraging those things that I had an interest in from a young age. I delivered project after project, but the funds were drying up and the education department that I was working in was to close. I moved to another department, luckily, and thrived in this department. I was surrounded by colleagues that had started on a similar path to me at the same time in the 90s with digital backgrounds. My male boss told me, "I trust you implicitly. I know what you've achieved. I see drive in you. Please develop the education business from the ground up. I have faith in you." And I did. That freedom allowed me to pitch and win business, much like an independent company. When I was questioned by those I was pitching to, how will that work technically? How much will it cost? What impact will this have on learners in Wales? What do you estimate the return on investment to be? How will you bring skills together to deliver? My previous experience allowed me to answer these questions confidently. And the digital education business I was building was growing. One year I reached a 68% increase in income. I was able to commission more and more from the independent sector in Wales. I was then offered a role in the central education department in England, but my heart was in Wales and serving Wales's audiences. During that year of massive growth, I went on maternity leave, and career-wise, it felt like it set me back. Towards the end of my maternity leave, we faced cuts and my role was to close. It was a really challenging time. I had to be interviewed for a slightly different, bigger role, but I got the job. Working in the digital education sector can mean working on amazing, near-on futuristic projects that touches millions. Being part of something big, innovative, and working on cutting-edge projects can have a real impact and make a tangible difference to society. Making the best possible content for learners with the aim of transforming their lives is a responsibility that I feel so privileged to have. I love my job. Finding and applying the best technical solutions to enable the commissioning and production of high-end creative content pieces that will spark learner imagination and inspire. I try to lead with drive and passion always. Every day, my role brings a new set of challenges. 2020 brought huge demands to all of us, but education finally received the recognition that it deserved. Everyone started to realise the importance of teachers and educationalists. In the BBC, it was time for BBC Education to show what we had been doing for years and how we could provide our public service remit at its very best. BBC Bite Size would be the main platform for supporting learners with their education. And the timeline of our work during COVID goes a little like this. Mid-March 2020, we knew we'd be locking down. We started planning. It was frantic. All of the heads across the UK, we were all planning together, trying to map out a service, trying to figure out what will work for all of the different nations as a UK service. We were trying to mobilise teams. We were having to communicate with senior individuals within the BBC and bringing partners on board fast. On the 26th of March, as we all know, we locked down. On the 3rd of April, a press release went out announcing that the BBC would deliver the biggest push on education in all its history from the 20th of April, and the pressure was on. Days and nights did blur into one for many of us, and our children craved for attention, and the guilt was there. The 20th of April, we went live with a huge digital offer and TV programming. The teams involved included digital leaders, creative directors, developers, engineers, camera operators, UX designers, information architects, data analysts, statisticians, teachers. I'm sure there's many more, and the list is endless, but the combined skills of all of those individuals is how we succeeded, everyone working together to help school children, teachers and parents with their education. Our data analysts started tracking our performance. 180 hours of programming was delivered and over 2,000 online lessons for primary and secondary school children. And it was worth it. We were averaging 4.1 million unique visitors per week. At our peak, we reached 5.2 million. Our normal target, in other words, outside of COVID, is an ambitious million per week. The lessons on iPlayer had been played over 5 million times by Christmas, and we thought we could breathe. But it wasn't to stop there. On the 4th of January, another announcement came to close the schools in England as well as the schools in Wales before Christmas. The 5th of January came, and all the heads of education across each of the UK nations are asked to shift on an even bigger service than the first time around, and we shifted. This time we delivered within less than a week. On the 11th of January, our new service was there. More digital content, more programming. This time on CBBC and BBC Two. BT would lift the charges on data for anyone accessing bite-sized content from home to make our content more accessible. On the 18th of January, we started broadcasting TV programmes in the Welsh language of SLC. Non-Welsh speaking parents were really struggling by the second lockdown, and I wanted to help in avoiding those parents losing confidence in their children attending Welsh schools. During lockdown, 15, 16-hour days became the norm. For the first 10 weeks, it was a straight 7-day week, and that's nothing to compare with what our NHS workers have done and continue to do so. The feeling of guilt for not being able to give our own children the time they deserve from us as parents was there still. And the irony of leading on education for the BBC in Wales, yet the homeschooling situation was almost non-existent. The other leaders in the other nations felt the same, and we supported each other. I remember being interviewed on the radio on the day of launch and not expecting the interviewer to ask me, "You have children here, how's the homeschooling going?" Waves of guilt kept hitting me, but was that really that different to other women working in leadership roles? For those working mums, please hang on in there. For those working mums in leadership roles, don't give up when you've got so far. Don't erase the progress of contributing to equality at work. In February of this year, we hit 5 million unique visitors. We were and are having an impact. It was worth it. And the way learners are learning is changing. COVID has accelerated this. The role of technology in education is vital now and into the future. We all know the benefits of having an equal, inclusive and diverse workforce. That's one of the reasons we're all here today. And that means that we need more digital skills in R&D, in digital innovation, in developing and crafting the platforms that we will need to help learners. We need creative content makers with that grounding in tech and digital. And we need to bring our teachers with us on the development journey. We need women with a tech digital background in schools to inspire young girls, and we need to give confidence to women who want to pivot into tech teaching careers. I love working in a cutting-edge industry which combines technology and creativity. I get to work with diverse people and the brightest and the most innovative minds. Many of them women, but not enough. I'd love to see more girls and women come into our industry, leveraging the skills and interests that you might not always see as a natural merge. Mathematics, arts and computing in my case. Women continue to be underrepresented in the digital industries. We're rare, we shouldn't be. We need women to feel empowered and find confidence to work in technology and the creative industries. We're getting there, but there's much more to do. Thanks so much for your time. I'd like to finish with a piece that was made by one of our fantastic producers in the department called Matt Gallup. The words are written for staff within BBC Education for the achievements during 2020, but hopefully it'll give you a flavour of the work that we do at BBC Education. Enjoy.
Things are a bit different right now. This and this now look more like this and this. Teaching isn't just a job for him and her, but for her and him too. So we had an idea.
Bite size daily.
Light, cameras, action.
A huge ninja. High five to all of you.
Work out how many of each goal type they scored.
Look, I didn't want to be a half-blood.
Hi, I'm Mabel.
Hey guys, it's Liam here.
Hey guys, I'm Pixie Lott.
Oh, I like that.
Oh, that is the school bell. You know what that means? School is out.
The actual time machine.
Why am I dressed up as a parrot?
Hi.
Back to the future.
Well, that was strange.
Liberation, elevation, education.
Katie, back of the net. Whee!
You did a better job than me.
Pretty much every single thing about the place loft is slow. They only actually go to the toilet once a week.
It was a special day indeed.
Melted strawberry ice cream. That is the mother of all cupcakes.
My name is Mim Sheikh. I'm a broadcaster, actor, and writer. If I'm able to do it on camera, it could help other people.
It's gold dust, really.
We've been engaged in a global conversation about race and racism.
When I was your age, and even younger, I experienced my fair share of racism.
White privilege doesn't mean you haven't worked hard or you don't deserve the success you've had. It simply means that your skin colour has not been the cause of your hardship.
I think it's fact. That can't be true. That is fake, thank you.
Get off your phone, you should be revising using BBC Bite Size.
School's off, learning's not.
Exams! BBC Bite Size! Crush it!
I think we don't need any more speeches, or dances, or anything else. I think it's time to go.
What a great video to end on! Fantastic! Thanks, Nia, for sending all that in. Hopefully, your internet will hold up so that you can take some questions from us as well. Hope you enjoyed all of that, everybody. Thank you, Nia, for putting that together. Thanks for everybody. And what you're doing with BBC is absolutely amazing. We just need a little bit more budget in Technocamps, Well, perhaps we'll have to do a bit more of a plea to Welsh Government on that one. And we might be able to bring up some quality standard like that. That was incredible, to attract the celebrities that you've got on board with you. Anyway, right, on to the questions, because we want to try and finish on time, because I'm sure an hour and a half at this time of night is quite precious. I'm going to start with one question. Are you ready, panellists? I'm going to start with Kirsty, if that's okay, because there was a question that came in which I thought was great. I've got to see if I can find it now. It was, Kirsty, tell us a story from your youth which shaped your career aspirations and set you on the path to leadership role that you now hold. I wasn't going to start with that one, but this one's great. I love it. Tell us a story from your youth.
Oh, my goodness me. Well, I do remember my father, my poor late father, coming home from a parents' evening and had been told by my English teacher, and these were the words she used, if Kirsty doesn't stop this politics nonsense, she's going to amount to nothing in life. And I guess for me, I've got a very stubborn streak, and being told that politics was not for me, made me even more determined. In those days, politics was my hobby, and I certainly didn't aspire to it for my job. I think what's been important to me in reflecting on what the other amazing women have said, and the heads up, Julie, about the question you might ask me about what's my biggest barrier been, I think, you know, undoubtedly there are very real barriers to women, and I don't want to downplay those, but I do think we have a role ourselves as individuals, and I think sometimes the thing that could have stopped me moving forward was myself, and a lack of belief either in my ability to do the job or being accepted by other people that I could do that job. And I think the most important thing that I've learned is to surround yourself with supportive people of both genders who are willing to absolutely support you through those times of self-doubt. And whilst I had a very dismissive English teacher, I had an amazingly supportive history and politics teacher who told me that I could do whatever I wanted, whatever I set my mind to. And so he, in my youth, was absolutely fundamental in getting me to where I am, but there have been critical people along the way. And, you know, when I was offered the job of being the education minister, I came down from the first minister's fifth floor office and I said to a friend of mine, this is what I've been offered and I can't do it. I can't do it. Because what if I fail in the most public way you could possibly fail? And luckily for me, she literally shook me, literally. Took me by the hands and shook me and said, I am not allowing you to pass up this opportunity, Kirsty. And, you know, it's surrounding with people like that who encourage you, but also call you out when you are in danger of not making the right decisions for you. So, yeah, Miss Charles, English teacher, who told me I would amount to nothing unless I stopped the politics nonsense.
Amazing. Who would have thought it? I mean, for every attribute, I suppose there's a positive and a negative. You can argue that, you know, somebody saying that you're dogged at something could be seen as a positive, that you've got tremendous perseverance. So, yeah, that's great. And actually brings me on to another question. But I'll go back to the original question because you did answer that one. And I'll ask this to Gwen. What's the biggest hurdle you have overcome in your career?
Well, you know, my answer is absolutely not dissimilar at all to Kirsty's comment just now. There are probably three things in my career, and not one of them isn't a career thing, actually. But when somebody says to me, no, you can't do that, that has the opposite effect on me, whether I'm just contrary or not, I don't know. But when I was a young reactor physicist working in a team with John Idris Jones, that many of you might know, he was my first boss. He was brilliant. And I decided I'd like to be a reactor operator, which was a different sort of working on shift and so on. And when I applied for the job, it's actually illegal to say this, and it probably was then, but a shift charge engineer said to me, no, we don't have women on shift. You'll alter the team dynamics and we won't be able to deliver. And I remember thinking, well, I don't agree with you, and I'm now going to find a way of getting to that role. And, you know, I'll show you. So that had the opposite effect than the one he perhaps imagined. And I got myself a job on shift and off we went. And there was two other occurrences of that in my life. One was somebody said to me, I was sort of contemplating whether I should get fit and run the London Marathon. And somebody said to me, oh, no, you can't run the London Marathon. So I did. 4.5 hours later, I finished the marathon. I think a pop noodle went past me on the finishing straight. But hey, I finished. So and finally, when I was a young engineer, I had never seen, you know, a female station director. And I remember talking with colleagues and they said, no, there probably won't be a female station director. So here we are. So for me, it's about adversity has made me better. But I just hope that the people coming after me don't experience that. They have their own challenges, but not the same ones. So that's mine.
Thanks for that. And I'm going to ask a question to you, Nia. Hopefully you've got good enough connection. What qualities did you need to become a leader in digital?
I think being able to work in an agile way helps, and having an ability to work in a fast-paced environment as well, working in tech and digital. Being a collaborative person as well, the amount of, you know, different individuals and stakeholders that you need to work with is broad. I think being curious as well in what, you know, what we would call end users or audiences want, and understand, you know, any emerging technologies as well, keeping on track with that, and always championing your team and bringing them with you. I think this year in particular, having empathy has really helped me, particularly, you know, during COVID and you know, how hard it's been for everybody. And then I'd say resilience then is probably this, because I can think of lots of things that probably apply for, you know, to lots of different jobs. But I think the last thing I'd say is being sort of ambassadors of change, because digital is fast paced. And that's what's brilliant about working in tech and digital. We've got really exciting roles, I think.
Fabulous. Thank you all. I could ask you questions all night, but I think you want to go home, don't you? And well, you are home, but you know, I think you want to put your feet up and go and have your tea and do whatever you need to do. So we're not going to ask any more questions, I don't think. But there's only one I would like to ask, which is, how do you balance that being a woman, maybe with children, and your career? How do you find that, and especially in a pandemic? Who would like to answer that one? I think Kirsty's nodding there. Go for it, Kirsty.
Oh my goodness me, I absolutely agree with Nia about the guilt about the homeschooling, because there hasn't been a lot of homeschooling going on in my house, you know, and I'm very fortunate that my children are older, they're teenagers, so they've been able to get on with it. But my goodness me, it's that guilt, I think, is always there. And I worry about it constantly, but now my children are older, you know, we've been able to sit down and have some conversations about it. And actually, they're much more perturbed at the prospect of me standing down, because what they've grown up with, they see as normal, and they're much more worried about me having me at home a bit more. I think you've got to be kind to yourself. Oh my goodness me, because sometimes we're not kind to ourselves. And you look around and you see those Instagrammable homes that are perfectly tidy, and the Instagrammable children who look absolutely angelic and in matching outfits. And, you know, I can barely get a comb through my hair of a morning, and I suffer from chaos, can't have anyone round syndrome, even without COVID, because I'd have to clean the house, you know. And if you open the cupboard under my stairs, you'd be collapsed under an avalanche of junk that has just been thrown in there. So I just think you've got to be realistic about what you can do, prioritise, and remember that... somebody bought me a fridge magnet, and this is no disrespect to people who are able to do this, but it said that, you know, sometimes boring women have immaculate homes, and you just got to prioritize what's important to you and your well-being and your family's well-being. And that's going to be different in individual cases. and be kind to yourself. And my girls say they wouldn't have had it any other way, and I've worried all through their lives, but they tell me now, wouldn't change a thing.
Fantastic. I think that's great. Anybody else want to come in on that, comment on that at all, Gwen or Nia?
Very much the same. You know, I think setting the tone, particularly if you're a leader or somebody who's able to influence other people and practice what you preach, stop, you know, switch the computer off. The world does not stop. And, you know, you've always got a phone in your pocket if people really need you, but really be disciplined. And, you know, I have insisted that we have some time at lunchtime where people go outside, we stop. And, you know, we can do that. But, you know, being a leader and making sure that others follow that is a very good discipline, I think.
Nia, do you want to come in at all? I think you touched on this in your talk.
Yeah, I think it's really good to hear from Kirsty and Gwen, actually. It's really helping. But I think, you know, similar to what Kirsty was saying, really, that, you know, that we need to sort of fine tune our perspective every now and again. And it's really helpful to overcome this type of hurdle. I think also for me during COVID, it really helped to have other women in leadership roles talk and tell you how they were feeling as well. And it just helped to be surrounded by those. And I think we tend to, you know, look at ourselves as women and we feel that we always need to do more. We need to be better. We need to do, you know, much more than what we're doing at the moment, but what we're actually doing is much better than just good enough. We're doing really well in balancing our careers and home life. So cutting ourselves some slack every now and again, I think, and hopefully that our children can look at us as role models in years to come.
Absolutely. That's fab. Thank you. I have a picture up on my wall and it says my house was tidy last week. Sorry, you missed it. I think I can I need to look at that every now and again and say, yeah, was it tidy last week? I'm not sure. But I think that it's great what you all said. And if you look at the comments that are in the comments from different people in the chat, you will see them all agreeing and nodding with what you're saying and relating to it and taking encouragement from it. So I'm hoping that from this evening that we've all had fun tonight, that we've all learned something new, and that we've all been inspired to do something new. So think about how you can put your hand up and stand up. Yes, I think that's our symbol for the evening. I want to say a big thank you to our speakers. I want to say a big thank you to our delivery officers who deliver. And I want to say a big thank you to Megan and Raza behind the scenes who've pulled this all together for us. So thank you all for this evening. I want to say Noswith Tha I Bawb, and thanks for joining us this evening.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Enjoy. Put your slippers on and do what you need to do.
Good night.
Good night.